So, the VMT-750. Now, thus far in the show, pretty much everything we've been looking at is a production machine or a machine that's going into production pretty soon from now. I just want to emphasize that this is a fully concept machine.
Yeah.
This is Haas's first approach to a mill turn machine. But even saying that, this machine is fully functioning, as we're going to see in a second here.
Yeah, we hope.
I'm going to give a little bit of the credit to that to Bhop Singh, one of our product specialists here, and he's been working with his baby for the last couple of weeks.
Yep.
Fine tune it.
Yeah.
Making sure
Hopefully.
There's no red lights. We'll see. A machine like this, I mean, this is obviously it's sitting on a VF base here.
Yeah, it's based on a VF 3YT, and we've added an ST15 lathe spindle to the table. So it's on the left-hand side on the X-axis. So
right, and so this is,
there you go, your turn mill.
It's kind of a more mill-focused interpretation
exactly,
of a mill turn than lathe focused.
Yeah, it's definitely based on the mill first, yeah.
But we're gonna see that it still does, it can turn apart just fine, as we're gonna see in a few minutes.
Yeah, we're gonna do a demo. We're gonna start with the lathe portion first, so let's talk about that first.
Yeah, let's do it.
All right, so we'll talk about the work envelope. Right now, if I orientate this tool to the turning position, from the tool tip to the front of the collet, the Haas lathe collet, which we'll talk about later.
That's
as
right
well,
at the end there.
Is about 23 inches. And then on the x-axis, sorry, there I go with the lathe guy again. On the z-axis, which is your diameter, from the tip to the center of the part is about 6.5 inches. So you can get a 12 inch, 13 inch diameter part safely in here with the right tooling.
When we were first looking at this machine, probably 2 weeks ago, I was thinking that we'd be looking at a work envelope like that.
Yeah.
But really, it's pretty substantial.
It equates to the same as, it's more than an ST15 actually, but it will change. The work envelope will get shorter as the B axis rotates. So that is another thing we have on the machine.
Right, we're gonna see that the spindle head rotates 90
Correct.
Degrees.
Yes.
So yeah, you would eat up some space when you're fully rotated like that.
Yeah.
Okay, cool.
So just to explain the difference, I'm just gonna go into
you wanna talk about the spindle, I think?
So yeah, so we've got the HSK63A, and we've got the standard turn mill turning tools in that
so
spindle.
It's off-the-shelf tooling. This isn't some custom tool that we made.
Yeah, it's
for
just
this
off
thing.
The shelf. Yeah.
Right.
So, and what's going to happen is the tools get loaded in. If there's a turning tool, we'll use M19 to orientate to the turn position, and it'll lock it in place with a brake, and then we can start turning. So
right. So it's held. That's how you hold it rigidly.
That's how it's
going to
get held.
Operation.
Yeah. And that's what we're going to see right now. So let's start with that.
Well, let's maybe real quick. You want to tell us? So let's say I have a Y-axis lathe.
Yeah.
What are the benefits of going with something like this?
Well, on the y-axis lathe, you're restricted because your y-axis and your x and your x minus as well.
You don't have that much travel on y-axis.
So you end up, when you start milling, you end up, the only option is using c-axis, which is fine, but it's not the go-to way to really mill. You really want to use your x, y, and z, and this machine allows that to happen. Yeah.
Right. Okay. Cool.
Yeah.
Let's
fire it up.
Let's fire it up. What everyone's been waiting for. Okay, so we're starting with the turning, right?
We're going to start with the turning. So there it is. It just orientated. I don't know if anybody can see that. And we're going to come in.
Sal, are you going to push in a little bit here to see this?
The brake's coming on. It's just going to face the part, and then we'll start turning.
All right.
So although it is a concept machine, we are still using recommended speeds and feeds with this insert. So it is running at about 1200 RPM, depth of cuts 100th hour side. Feed rate's in inches per minute, it's 20 inches a minute.
So your metal removal rate's pretty standard, right?
It's 16 thou per rev. It's actually on the high end of that insert recommended, so.
Yeah, it looks like it's getting pretty good.
It's cutting solid, it's just like the lathe, so.
Yeah.
I'm excited because, you know, this is a concept machine and it works so well, so far.
You've had a lot of successful runs of this thing, so we shouldn't see any surprises, I'm hoping.
Like
maybe
I said,
we have a get-out-of-jail-free card.
There you go.
Maybe not.
So we're just roughing up a simple profile. We're going to come in now with the finish tool.
Okay, so of course, oriented to take the tool out with the tool changer.
Yeah, locking it position. I'm just going to check the R value is correct, just to make sure it's engaging
correctly. Yeah, so you've got optional stops in here, so you can...
Like I said about the x-axis and the y-axis being larger, you can actually put a larger part in here that you can turn and mill here, whereas before maybe you had it on two machines. So
right. Right. So it does, yeah, it definitely gives you more options.
More options.
In terms of travel this way, and
yes.
a size part you can fit this way.
Yeah. And the final lathe tool we're going to use is the groove tool. We're just going to make a little groove at the back so we can start showing you the milling.
Right. And so it's probably obvious, but each time, now you've got a different M19 orientation here for this tool, straight on to the part than
Correct.
You did for the turning insert.
Yes, yeah. But
right.
like I said, these are standard holders for all these lathe tool holders. So.
So what you would be typically, the alignment of your tool stick that you might typically be setting with, you know, between the tool holder and the turret is now accomplished all just by a different M19 setting, right?
Exactly, yeah. And let's talk about the lathe portion. It's just finished.
You bet.
So what makes me excited about having a lathe tool inside a mill spindle is I'm always worried about the neighboring tools getting in the way.
On a regular lathe.
On a regular lathe in a turret, you're always worried about tools hitting the jaws or hitting the part or hitting the chuck.
Right.
This tool, I'm not worried about that.
It's all by itself in there, right? Yeah.
There's no turret and there's no neighboring tools, so that's the exciting bit. Plus, on a lathe, you're restricted to how many tools you can put into a turret, and here we've got 50 tools.
Right, you might have commonly maybe a 12 station turret or something.
Exactly.
So this has got like four times at least that many.
Yeah, you've got 50 tools in there, plus you don't have to worry about clearances, so there's no taking tools out of one position, swapping tools around, and you can build up such a big tool magazine of parts, so you can do all range of different parts without setting up
Tools. You've got a lot more jobs you can run potentially before you have to start doing
new
tool offsets and stuff like that.
There you go, yeah.
Cool.
So now we're gonna do the milling. The first thing we're gonna talk about is the B axis. That's the different feature we've got on this VF3. So here we go with the mill portion.
Alright, so of course you go move away to a safe position and do the tool change.
Yeah.
So we're gonna watch it do the milling first, and then maybe we're gonna take a look
If Sal can get in there, the first thing we're gonna do is actually go towards a part, and it will orientate to the B axis of 5 degrees, just slight little portion.
So you're doing several different angular positions.
Yeah, the B axis goes from 0 to 90 degrees, and what that allows is for us to do angle planes, so we can machine features on different angle planes. So today we're doing it on 5 degrees. Then we're going to move over to 15 degrees, and we'll show some.
We'll show some drilling as well, right?
Correct. Yeah.
Yeah. So the 90-degree part is the part that scares me a lot.
Yeah. So we're just milling out a flat, and then we'll do a little pocket, and then it's just going to move out of the way. But as you can see, as it's traveling in X, the Z is moving as well, so it's keeping that 5-degree flat perfect.
Right. So you can't. It's a little bit difficult to see here on 5 degrees, but when you get to the 15-degree, particularly with the drill, you can see that those things are moving in simultaneously.
They're,
of course.
They're moving in sync. Yeah.
Right. So kind of similar to how you do on it. Very much similar to how you do on a Y-axis motion on our lathe.
It allows you to do more intricate and complex parts. So it does bring another dimension to this lathe, mill, and B-axis. Yeah.
Right. Right. So that was okay. All the 5 degree there.
That was a
so
5 degree.
Now you're reorienting, or you're going to do a tool change.
We're going to do a tool change. We're going to do on the taper there. It's 15 degrees. We're going to mill a keyway.
Okay.
So that's going to orientate 15 degrees.
So there you
go. There you go. Yeah.
Now obviously here, if you didn't have those axes moving simultaneously, up and down and in and out, you'd just be digging a big trench in your part.
Yeah, you'd be making a bit of a mess really.
And probably it would certainly breaking the tool as well.
Yeah.
So these are Haas tools in here, by the way, right?
The end mills you're just seeing right now and the one before that, they are Haas tooling.
Okay, cool. Yeah, yeah. We'll take a quick look at those at the end.
Yep. So usually when you're doing complex stuff like this, it's done on several different machines, special fixtures. The cost can go up. I've just stopped the machine because we're not using any coolant. I'm just going to blow the chips off before we drill it. And then
this gives you the opportunity to do much more complex parts. That's what you're going to use a machine like this for.
Yeah.
You kind of have a story about how engineering here is, probably most people know that engineering at Haas is always kind of trying to simplify things, which is always a good idea.
Okay, we're just going to quickly watch this.
Yeah, let's.
Self can get in and watch this. So we're at 5 degrees. We're just going to put a couple of holes into that pocket we just milled. But then we're going to swing around. It should clear the part. Go across to B90.
Yay. There we go.
There you go.
That's the one that scares me every time.
And we're going to punch a couple of holes in the front face as well.
That is
so,
slang.
Like I said, the options on this to make intricate parts is...
Right, so you could do a host of different kinds of machining on the front face of the part.
Yeah. And also the B-axis, you can machine on it, so you can do curve machining, you can do contour machining.
So you don't, yeah, we don't have tool center point control active on this machine.
Not on this
yet,
machine right now, but it will be.
Certainly going to be planned for that, right?
And then the final tool is just going to come in and do chamfer the profile.
Right.
Yeah, like you said, with engineers, they've come down to the shop and they've said, hey, Bhop, we're going to design this. And I'm said, no. To keep the cost down, they've actually split that one component into two different designs so they can machine them easily.
Right, right. Because you're going to have some milling and some turning
and so forth. It can cycle time and cost goes up, so they reduce that by splitting up the parts.
But this machine kind of allows you to go the other direction, right?
It goes the other direction, yeah. I walked the shop a couple of weeks ago in assembly and found quite a few components that we could actually reduce into one just by having this one machine here.
That's slick. And there's a huge number of examples of that out in industry. You know, there's plenty of complex parts out there where you need this kind of machine for that kind of work.
Exactly.
Yep. Okay, so we did all of the chamfering there.
Yeah, so that's all finished. I'll show the B-axis just to show you about
So you're going to just show us what you call vector jog, right?
Yeah, John mentioned it in the showcase yesterday for the GM2,
right,
about if you are doing it at a vector, of doing it at an angle and you're drilling and alarm goes off.
And something goes wrong.
Does something ever go wrong? No.
No, nothing ever goes wrong.
But yeah, your drill's stuck inside the part and you don't want to break anything. It's going to be really hard to come out at that axis.
Yeah, if you can't jog the axes together, then you're gonna break something.
Something's going to break. So I'll tell you what we'll do. We'll just come down here, move the B axis to a certain angle, let's go 25 degrees. Okay, so right now, if that's stuck in a part, you're not gonna get it out by using X,
right,
Y, or Z.
Right.
So, but you can.
Like you were saying, you're probably gonna take the part out if you can and pull it off of the drill.
Yeah, but a vector jog is, it's easy to, it highlights the whole.
Yeah, so that's cool. So that there you know you're in that mode.
Yeah, so now, as you can see, as I'm going up in Z, the X table is moving across as well.
Right, right.
So that drills
safely. Yeah, you can really see that. Yeah, you can see the simultaneous motion there.
Exactly.
Easily. Now all you've got to do is remember which way to go, right?
That's true, yeah.
Not being a machinist, that's my problem.
And that's it, that's the
cool
built in.
Well, we want to take a quick look at some of the tools that we're using here, right?
Yes.
This is all stuff that's on HaasTooling.com.
Yes, if Frank can pull up
the first slide. Yeah, Frank, you want to pull up those slides?
Yeah, cool. So the second section, the mill section, we were using two end mills and a drill. That's from HaasTooling.com.
Right. So we got those here, end mill. And then this is one of the inserts you're using
inserts are soon to be released.
Yeah, the lathe inserts aren't on HaasTooling.com yet, but they're soon to be there along with... a host of other stuff that you're going to see tomorrow over in the demo room. But we also want to look at another thing that is coming soon.
Yeah, it's the Haas Collet chuck. And this is it here. We were talking before about reducing setup times. Like I said, with 50 tools in the pocket, you can set up a whole number of range of parts and save those tools and never have to remove them.
Right, and the other half of that is something
this,
like this.
This option is fantastic. So what I'm going to do right now is I'm going to say
we're
going to finish this setup.
Essentially swap out a job, right?
Yeah, we'll take this part out.
I'll give you that.
Here's what I prepared earlier. Right, so I'm going to use
that's right. I can't give you that first.
Yeah.
What am I doing?
I'm going to use a collet gun. I'm going to remove
that. Pull one collet out.
Yep.
Go blow it out, yeah.
Make sure everything's clean.
So that index is in there. You've got some kind of alignment tab or something, right?
Yeah, that's it.
All right, that was pretty quick.
So far, so good.
This is the easy part.
So now we've got a 1-inch bar, stick out what size you want. You're actually ready for the next
setup. You're completely switched over, and your work offset is probably going to be off of the face of this truck.
Exactly,
right?
So
that
you can continue running.
Changed,
yeah, you've set up
your
for the
program
next
references that.
Correct.
So you've got a huge number of tools up here for a huge number of jobs, and you've got really quick switch out there.
So the gun and the collet choke plus the master jaws, they're all going to be available soon on HaasTooling.com.
So super high production possibilities here.
Yeah.
So that kind of wraps it up for the VMT-750, right?
Yep.
Thank you so much for showing us around and getting this demo running, because I know people are pumped to see it. I certainly was. So as we were mentioning, this is definitely a concept machine. And given that, we're really interested in knowing what you think of it. And what ways would you use this machine? A little birdie told me that we're thinking about a price range in the $150,000 range. So take that into consideration. Of course, there's a lot of complexity here. What kind of parts would you make with a machine like this? What kind of applications do you see it being used in? And would you do things, do you have any suggestions? We'd love it if you'd add something in the comments or in the chat to let us know what you think of this. And we'll be watching those carefully. Given that, I think we're ready to switch over to the next machine here.